Cambridge IGCSE Physics Major 2020, Paper 42, Part 1. Question 1. Figure 1.1 shows the speed time graph of a person on a journey. On the journey, he walks and then waits for a bus. He then travels by bus. He gets off the bus and waits for 2 minutes. He then walks again. His journey takes 74 minutes. This isn't a bar graph, although it looks like one. These parts are just at zero speed. Part A. For the whole journey, calculate the distance traveled. To find the distance from a speed time graph, you need to find the area under the graph, which are these shaded areas. Be careful, the units are different. Speed is in kilometers per hour and time is in minutes. So when we calculate, we need to change minutes to hours by dividing it by 60. So length times height, 20 over 60 times 5 plus 20 over 60 times 40 plus 22 over 60 times 6. The answer is 17 kilometers. The average speed. Average speed is total distance traveled divided by total time. We just found the total distance traveled, 17, so divide this by 74 minutes, given in the question. Change 74 minutes to hours. 17 divided by 74 over 60, 14 kilometers per hour. Part B. State and explain which features of a speed time graph shows acceleration. There are two parts in this question. You first need to state what it is and explain why it is so. In a speed time graph, the gradient represents acceleration. This is because when you calculate the gradient, you are dividing speed with time, and speed divided by time is acceleration. Part C. State and explain the acceleration of the person at time equals to 40 minutes. When time is at 40 minutes, the graph is a straight horizontal line. If it's a straight horizontal line, it means that the gradient is zero. This means that acceleration is zero, and the reason is because the gradient is zero. Question 2. Figure 2.1 shows a train. The total mass of the train and its passengers is 750,000 kilograms. The train is traveling at a speed of 84 meters per second. The driver applies the brakes and the train takes 80 seconds to slow down to a speed of 42 meters per second. Part A. Calculate the impulse applied to the train as it slows down. The question sounds confusing, but just think about which formula you should use to solve this part of the question. Impulse equals to change in momentum, which in formula is mv minus mu. M stands for mass, 750,000 kilograms, v final velocity, 42 meters per second, and u initial velocity, 84 meters per second. Substitute the values, and the answer is 3.2 times 10 to the power of 7. The unit can be either Newton seconds or kilogram meter per second. Part B. Calculate the average resultant force applied to the train as it slows down. We just found the impulse, and one other formula related to impulse is impulse equals to force multiplied by time. Since we need to find the force, rearrange the equation, impulse divided by time. Impulse was 3.2 times 10 to the power of 7, and time is given here, 80 seconds. Check your units. Yeah, both are in seconds. The answer is 3.9 times 10 to the power of 5 newtons because it's a force. Part C. Suggest how the shape of the train helps it to travel at high speeds. The train has a streamlined shape. This is the streamlined shape, and this is the best known shape that reduces air resistance. So you can write the streamlined shape of the train helps reduce air resistance experienced by the train. Part D. The train took 80 seconds to reduce its speed from 84 meters per second to 42 meters per second. Explain why, with the same braking force, the train takes more than 80 seconds to reduce its speed from 42 meters per second to zero. So why does it take longer to slow down if you're traveling at a lower speed? This can be a tricky question. Well, it's because when the train is moving at a slower speed, there is less air resistance against it. This time, you're trying to reduce your speed, so the higher the air resistance, the easier it is for you to slow down. But at lower speeds, there is obviously less air resistance, so you need more time to reduce the same amount of speed. Part E. On a wet day, the train travels a greater distance before it stops along the same track. The train has the same speed of 84 meters per second before the brakes are applied. Suggest a reason for this. Same thing for cars and bikes. On a wet day, when you stop, you're going to travel slightly further than you usually do. This is because, well, the roads are wet and slippery and there's less friction, so you slide along the road. If we apply this concept to a train in terms of physics, we say the friction force between rails and train is reduced on a wet day, so it travels a greater distance before it stops. Question 3. Part A. A solar panel receives energy from the sun at a rate of 5.0 kilowatts. Thermal energy is transferred from the solar panel to water with an efficiency of 20%. Cold water of mass 15 kilograms enters the solar panel every hour. The specific heat capacity of water is 4,200 joules per kilogram degree Celsius. Calculate the temperature increase of the water. First, identify what kind of information we're given with. We know the power, efficiency, mass of water, and specific heat capacity of water, and we need to find the temperature change. When you see the phrase specific heat capacity in a question, this formula should immediately pop up in your mind. Energy equals to mass times specific heat capacity times change in temperature. We know the mass, specific heat capacity. We need to find the change in temperature, and energy can be calculated from power. The solar panel receives energy at a rate of 5 kilowatts, but not all energy is transferred to water. The efficiency is given, it's 20%, and efficiency equals to energy output divided by energy input. Keep in mind that you need to write these equations in words to get marks. So 20% equals to energy output divided by 5 kilowatts, which is 5,000 watts. Energy output is 1,000 watts. This is a rate in watts, so we need to convert it to energy in joules. Power equals to energy divided by time, so energy equals to power times time. Time is actually given here every hour. So multiply with 1 hour, but convert it to seconds because that's the SI unit of time. 1,000 times 3,600, 3,600,000, this is the final energy input. Then back to this formula, 3,600,000 equals to mass 15 times specific heat capacity, 4,200 times temperature change. Rearrange the equation, calculate it, and you get 57 degrees Celsius. Part B. State and explain one advantage and one disadvantage of heating the water in a solar panel compared with heating the water in a coal-burning boiler. The advantage is that it's good for the environment since the energy from the sun is renewable, and no air pollution is caused compared to when using a coal-burning boiler. The disadvantage is that it's quite expensive to install one, and you need a proper roof for that. Also, it won't be available at night, so it can be inconvenient. Question 4. Figure 4.1 shows a liquid in glass thermometer without a temperature scale. The liquid inside the thermometer has a melting point of minus 39 degrees Celsius. Part A. Describe simple experiments to mark the positions of the fixed points on this liquid and glass thermometer. It says simple, but it's a 4-mark question, so you know that your explanation shouldn't be simple. To scale a liquid and glass thermometer, there are fixed steps for this. First, put it in melting ice. You'll see a point where the liquid inside the thermometer, it's called bead, stops moving. Remember, there is no temperature change in melting ice because all energy is used up to change its state. So when bead inside the thermometer stops moving, it means it has reached the melting point, and mark that point as 0 degrees Celsius. Then put it in steam above boiling water. Again, the bead inside the thermometer will stop moving. It's water's boiling point where there is no temperature change, so mark that point as 100 degrees Celsius. Part B. A scientist is measuring temperatures at the South Pole. These temperatures have a minimum value of negative 90 degrees Celsius. State why the liquid used in the thermometer in Figure 4.1 would not be suitable for this scientist. In the first part of the question, it mentioned that the melting point is negative 39 degrees Celsius. If this is brought to the South Pole where the minimum temperature is negative 90, it's going to freeze and won't be in a liquid state. Part C. State a design change that increases the sensitivity of a liquid in glass thermometer. To increase the sensitivity of a thermometer, we can use a thinner tube. In this way, you will easily spot a small change in temperature. Another way is to use a liquid that expands more per unit change in temperature. The liquid will be more sensitive and travel more from the same temperature change. Increase the range of a liquid in glass thermometer. To increase its range, it's simple, just get a longer tube so the liquid can travel more up and down the thermometer. Part D. State the property of the liquid which ensures that the scale on the liquid in glass thermometer is linear. Only certain types of liquid with this property can be used in liquid in glass thermometers. It's when they expand uniformly with temperature. For example, if it expands by 1 cm cubed for 1 degree Celsius change, it needs to expand by 10 cm cubed for 10 degrees Celsius change. Question 5. Figure 5.1 shows crests of a wave approaching a barrier where the wave is reflected. Wave is traveling from this direction, and there's a barrier here. Part A. On Figure 5.1, draw three crests of the reflected wave. It can be confusing if you try to draw this straight away. So draw a normal for each crest first. Three straight vertical lines perpendicular to the barrier. Now, identify the angle of incidence. This is the angle of incidence for this wavefront, and this question is about reflection, so the angle of reflection on the other side of the normal should be the same as well. So draw a reflected wavefront with same angle of reflection like this. Do these for the second and third ones. Erase these vertical lines, we don't need to show it here. All diagrams are drawn with pencil. Make sure the wavefronts are parallel to each other, and the wavelength, the gap between the wavefronts, are the same as well. Always remember, draw the normal first, identify the angle of incidence, imagine where your angle of reflection should be, and draw the reflected line. Then, erase the normal. Part B. The wave has a wavelength of 36 cm and a speed of 1.2 meter per second. Calculate the frequency of the wave. The formula related to this question is speed equals to frequency times wavelength. So to find the frequency, is speed divided by wavelength. Be careful of the units. Speed is in meter per second, it's correct, it's in SI unit, but wavelength is in centimeters. It needs to be in meters as the SI unit of length is meters. So 36 divided by 100 to convert it to meters, it's 0.36 meters. Now we can use this formula. 1.2 divided by 0.36, 3.3 Hz. Always pay attention to units in physics. Part C. Complete the following sentences. An echo is the name for a reflected something wave. We hear the echo, so it's a reflected sound wave. The waves that form an echo are a type of longitudinal wave. Longitudinal waves are made up of something and rarefactions. They are made of compressions and rarefactions. It's an easy question. Alright, I'll do the rest of the paper in my next video. Did this video help you? Let me know in the comments to motivate me. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, like, and share my videos to support me. Stay safe and God bless you guys. Bye!